Okay, good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
And thank you all for coming out. This is the first of our four-week Lenten reflection series, The Art of Beauty. And so a little housekeeping. I have a few handouts left if you didn't get one. I'll come around. Father Peter will get one too. So we're delighted that you could join us tonight. And the first installment of this series is with Christa Dalmazio. Christa is a soprano, classically trained vocalist, also multi-instrumentalist. She's working on her doctorate in musical arts at the Manhattan School of Music. And she also serves as director of music at Holy Innocents Parish in Neptune in the Diocese of Trenton. Not the planet, just the Diocese of Trenton. So without further ado, Christa, thank you.
Thank you so much. I'm so excited to be here and so excited to tackle this very transcendental topic. Where do we begin? So I want to start with some questions for you to think about. What is music? What is beauty? Why does certain music evoke joy or sadness? And why does some music remain regarded as beautiful through all of music history? Why does certain music leave us filled with wonder? So I'm going to invite you to listen to about 30-second clips, a few clips of music. And as soon as the clip finishes, I want somebody to raise their hand really quick and tell me one word to three words of reaction to an emotion that this music evokes.
Thank you.
in doom.
Yes, this is from, oh, does anybody want to guess the composer? Not sure. Okay, this is Richard Strauss's Elektra opera. At the very end of the opera, Elektra falls down dead at this point of the opera. So that is personally how I'm feeling. Then we have one more clip. So, I'm going to start from the very, very beginning of music, the human voice. So, from the moment that Adam and Eve, when Eve woke up and Adam saw her, and he was like, oh my gosh, it's another human. She looks like me. I need to try to communicate with her. From the moment of trying to talk, trying to communicate something from your body, the human voice contains music. The human voice actually has a pitch, and the pitch of the average human voice is around B or middle C on the piano. You speak amongst a few different pitches, because I'm not talking monotone like this, but mostly around one pitch. And this is the beginning of music. So it's with communication and music begins. Then the human only wanted to communicate a sentiment. What do you have to form words? You have to communicate a message to the recipient of the information. And then this is intended to evoke an emotional response. You want the person you're talking to get what you're saying and to react to you. This is also involved in music. So, in this emotional response, what creates this is harmony, melody, a progression of harmonic progression, and something that I want to talk about is consonance versus dissonance. Two notes sounding beautiful together to almost anyone's ear would be a pleasant sound, like a deep breath. And if there's a little bit of anxiety, like in the Stravinsky, there are notes that are not quite going together, and those are dissonant. So when dissonance is released, then you feel that deep breath feeling. And, oops. Okay. Beautiful music leaves us in a state of wonderment. This is essential to considering music that is beautiful. It leaves wonderment and it activates our imagination. This is something I'll be talking about more later. So music is interesting. It's different than art on a canvas or architecture of a building you can look at and it's just there. Music is an experience in the present moment. The moment you hear the music, it's gone in the next second, and then the memory of the music is left behind. So how is a composer to compose something that you receive and that you're going to remember and have an emotional response to that most people would agree with? So that's what we're going to be talking about as well. So why does certain music appear beautiful no matter who is listening, from what background, different culture, different language, and different faith? This is almost an impossible question to answer in a definition of a dictionary, but I want to leave you walking out of here thinking about things and saying, oh, okay, this is fair, and looking at music with more of a lens of curiosity when you leave tonight. So I'm going to start, I was thinking, okay, if I start talking about music, I have to talk about what makes a single note beautiful. And this is the beginning, the first note of a piece is very important. You remember the motif from Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, bum, 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 bum. Okay, who doesn't know that? Everybody knows that motif. So what makes a single note beautiful? This, okay, we already talked about the human voice. Now I'll talk about what makes something about the human voice beautiful or not beautiful. Why are some voices really pleasant to listen to and some are kind of like, a little disturbing, a little distracting. So So there's something that happens when you speak that's a preordained order of what happens, created by God, that's from nature, called the overtone series. And it's a little bit complicated to explain, but I'm just going to brush the surface of what this is. So, okay, it's a little hard to see on here, but the note all the way to the left of the music staff is C. This is called a fundamental. This is the pitch that you hear when speaking. This is the pitch that your brain recognizes. Let's say that's the first pitch. Within this pitch, there are actually thousands of pitches above this that are a little bit softer that you don't hear, that's bringing warmth and beauty and sentiment to the sound of my voice. So I'll play for you an example of what all of these pitches sound like in succession. Oh, you know what? Let me try this. Okay. Really confusing concept to try to understand, but you walk around every day hearing single pitch in people's voices. All of those intervals of pitches are sounding at the same exact time over one pitch. This is what's bringing the color and beauty to the sound. The word timbre, I may refer to again in the rest of the lecture, timbre is another word for color, for the quality of the sound. So if we didn't have overtones from God's creation in nature, it would sound very harsh and unappealing to the ear. And I'm going to play an example of what one note without overtones sounds like. This is what it would sound like.
1,000 hertz.
Right. It kind of makes you cringe a little bit. It's kind of like, oh no, this is going to give me hearing loss. What the heck is going on? So this pitch is a sine wave without any overtones. And it's like, what? Okay, so we don't even know this is happening every day. God's creation is so amazing, so mind-blowing that he has this already programmed into any pitch that we hear. So this is so fascinating to me. So that's what makes one pitch beautiful and warm. Okay. So, oh, one more thing. To demonstrate timbre and color, I think this might be a little bit clearer if anyone's still confused about this. So if I with my voice sing a dark color to one note and I make the same pitch brighter and take away the overtones, you can actually do that with your voice to a certain extent, not like a computer, but this is an example of what it would be. So if I would pick one pitch and sing dark to light, it would be straight, and the last sound was a lot brighter than the first sound I sang. So you can actually have the same pitch, even though it may sound like it's going up in pitch, it's not the same pitch, and you're taking away overtones. So the quality of the human voice also makes the music more or less beautiful. Also, okay, next. So we're going to be talking about beauty as an attribute of divine. This is a little hard to see, but I'm just going to speak it up. So, if you've probably heard the transcendentals referred to of truth, goodness, and beauty. And if you're trying to say, what is God the pinnacle of? God is the pinnacle of beauty, truth, and goodness. And we're called to seek out and reflect these qualities because our purpose here is found in growing to know, love, and serve God. So if we're growing to learn more about the beauty of music, we're actually we're going to search to grow in deeper relationship with God. So if God is something that is true, the pinnacle of truth, truth is not subjective. I think we would all be able to agree on that. Beauty is the same. So I'm going to have you begin to think about the concept that beauty is also objective. People say, oh, beauty is in the eye of the beholder. Some people may think that a piece that we think sounds ugly, maybe beautiful, is not true. So I'm going to give you some things to think about for why is it possible for beauty to be objective. Okay. So Austrian music critic Edward Hanslick said, "The beautiful aims at nothing in particular. If the contemplation of something beautiful arouses pleasurable feelings, this is not subject to the aim of the music, but a result of its beauty." So us perceiving some emotional response from it is just the result of it being beautiful in itself. The beautiful remains beautiful, although there may be no one to look at it. Sina is saying if a tree falls in the forest and no one's around to hear, does it make a sound? This is the same concept. So if an object is beautiful and no one's there to see it, it remains beautiful. Okay. In Hanslick's opinion, the art and music aim above all at producing something beautiful, which affects not only our feelings, but the organ of pure contemplation, our imagination. So in other words, beauty has to have this quality to evoke an imaginative response as well. Otherwise, it's not really beautiful. And just briefly talk a little bit about Thomas Aquinas's exploration of beauty. With Thomas Aquinas, you have to be careful because if you think, oh, this is definitely his definition from the Summa, not really, he's beginning to unpack something. So to talk about his beginning to explore beauty, he says that beauty consists of three elements: integritas, or integrity, wholeness; consonantia, proportion; and claritas, or clarity, or wonder, or radiance. And he held the view that beauty being objective is dependent on the object itself and the effect that the object has on the listener. So we were observing really exciting music in the beginning, so we were observing the effect it has on the listener and what it is in itself. Okay, so just a little more about that. Integritas in music, so there are certain elements required for music to be considered music. Melody, rhythms, harmony, timbre, the color thing we were talking about before, and texture. For consonancia, or proportionality, in music, examples of this are the organization of time. So with music, we're organizing time, we're putting pitches to the time. So phrases, or the musical sentence, proportions of notes, proportions of rests, the form of a sonata, the form of a symphony, the form of a song, etc. And I'll give more examples of this, especially in Bach. It's going to blow your mind. You'll see it later. Okay. And then for claritas, which also equals what the music radiates or the wonderment it leaves you with, in music, elements of this would be shown through the text of vocal music, or in the program notes of an instrumental piece meant to tell a story, or the clarity of a key of a piece. So claritas is the quality of wonder that is part of our experience that remains in our memories in association with the beauty in the music. So this might be what causes you to tear up listening to something so beautiful you don't know why. You're like, why is listening to something causing me to cry when I'm not upset at any particular person? I'm just listening to this music and it's so beautiful. So this would be this element of claritas. Okay. So I'm going to talk a little bit about medieval vocal music. This is really the beginnings of music being written down in some sort of standardized notation. And the monks of Salem standardized the plain chant in little tiny square notes. You've probably seen them before. Neumes, they're called. It was developed in the 3rd and 4th centuries, and the monks in France standardized it in the 12th century, around that time. So I'm going to talk a little bit about St. Hildegard von Bingen's. She's also a doctor of the church. Her chant, O Virtus Sapientiae. I'll just read the translation so you know what the chant is about. I actually have an image of one of her illustrations that she has drawn. It's a three-winged looking creature, and this represents wisdom to her. So the text is, O wisdom's energy, whirling, you encircle and everything embrace in the single way of life. Three wings you have. One soars above into the heights, one from the earth exudes, and all about now flies the third. Praise be to you, as is your due, O wisdom. Now, I'm going to sing the chant so you can hear what it sounds like. Oh.
Number four represents God's creation or the earth.
Number 5 represent the wounds of Christ, the 5 wounds of Christ. Number 6 represents the evil of man, or man's fallen nature. And number 7 represents completion, or perfection, or rest, like God rested on the seventh day of creation. Those just some of the numbers 1 through 7. So I did some analyzing of this piece, and you can't see it that well in here, so don't worry about that if you can't see the music, but the form is a two-part invention, so maybe it would be companionship or division. It begins in D minor, which is the number one, we'll call that number one key of this piece, and it ends on A, which is the fifth key of this association of the piece. And the whole piece is 52 measures long. The 26th bar, which is exactly halfway point, is when the key goes to number 5, to A. It's called the dominant. And then it ends in D minor at the end again. So it's exactly proportionate in the middle. It changes to the new key. And then instead, there are two, the main theme of this piece are these two measures. Okay, approximately. That's the main theme. In the right hand, there are 7 complete statements. In the left hand, there are 5 complete statements of this. So those numbers have a lot of significance. There are 2 long trills that occur around the center of the piece, equally proportionately, and there are little rests, these 8th rests, the only 8th rests in the piece, there are exactly 8. So we have a lot of significance in the numbers to Bach, so that you listen to this piece and you're wondering, wow, it's effortlessly beautiful. Why is it beautiful? Could it be that he imbued the piece with so much meaning associated with these numbers? Some music critics have also agreed with this idea. So I just wanted to give a few things to think about there about Bach. Well, that's just scratching the surface of the proportionality of his music. Everything is exactly planned out to a T. Yet you listen to this music and it just sounds like it's flowing, like it's coming from heaven. Why is it like that? It could be, or the quality that St. Thomas Aquinas said was consonantia, which is proportionality, that could have that element in here. So one is able to listen to the piece, feel the flowing and effortless nature, and even though it's highly organized, and it's not constricted to a box, but the goal in mind is to maybe superimpose, the goal is not to superimpose an ideology of his faith. You just receive it. You receive the beauty, and that is even getting to know a glimpse of God's beauty through a piece like this that's so beautiful. Okay, so actually, if we're talking about so much beautiful music, we're going to talk about a piece of music of contrast that I consider, you may agree, you may not agree, music with the absence of beauty. So this piece of music actually is highly, highly organized, but it's not concerned with anything else. This composer's name is Milton Babbitt, and he was a serial composer. Not serial like Captain Crunch cereal. Serial serial composition means that everything is mathematical, and you take sets and patterns of numbers and you associate them with notes, and you just paste it out to the music, and that's what it is. It sounds like a whole mishmash of notes, and you'll see in a second. So this piece is called Philomel, and it combines a synthesizer with a live recorded soprano voice. You think that the voice, we're talking about the voice so much, let's see if the voice is what it sounds like here, and it's also with these sine waves, which I also talked about before. Different colors that a computer could produce, and changing the quality of a tone without changing the pitch or through the frequency. So this is something that is not natural to the natural world. It's somebody who intentionally used a computer to try to do something opposed to God's creation, actually. If you think about it, you're taking away overtones, you're taking away the natural sounds from the world that God created, and you're trying to just do something for the computer's sake. What? I don't know. I don't think it's very beautiful. That's my argument here. So it has a lot of consonancia, but nothing else. It's not concerned with melody or beauty at all. So that was not the composer's intention. So I think that's very interesting. Back to the beautiful music. Okay, so this next piece is from the Renaissance time period by Giovanni Pierluigi da Palestrina. And this piece is, the text is Omanium Mysterium, which comes from a Gregorian chant. And the translation, if you can't see it over there, it's, O great mystery and wonderful sacrament, that animals should see the newborn Lord lying in a manger. Blessed is the virgin whose womb was worthy to bear the Lord Jesus Christ. Alleluia. So I'm going to play just a portion of this for the interest of time. So here is Palestrina.
Thank you.
Do matter, and they contribute to the beauty of the music. This is kind of my summary of what I believe beautiful music should have. See if you agree with me or not. You can let me know in the questions afterwards. Did I miss something? Did I get something wrong? So music itself, music. If it's beautiful, it is music. If it's not beautiful, not worth calling music. So music should glorify, praise, and lift our minds to God through the message, through the text, or maybe through even the talents of the musicians. Because if somebody is not very talented at singing something, and it also contributes with the quality of the human voice contributes to the beauty, then second, it should contain the integrity, proportion, and clarity that St. Thomas Aquinas said, and it should contain a message of truth. So within the storytelling, it should contain truth, what the words are, or if it's just instrumental music, the reason, you know, what, like for Vivaldi's Spring and Summer, you know, what is it meant to be signifying? Music should not have the sole intention of being different, progressive, or break previous traditions. So if that was the intention of Milton Babbitt, and that's his only aim, and he wants to do something different, he's so fascinated by the computer, that's not worth composing music of that. So also, music should not portray evil or base elements of this world without truth, from which we can still draw the Christian hope of redemption. So for instance, in modern music, in our modern society, there are some pieces of music that may have somebody's redemption story. For example, the opera Don Giovanni by Mozart, the guy gets dragged down to hell at the end, it's not very redeeming, but we can learn from the story, maybe there's a lesson to be learned, maybe I shouldn't be like Don Giovanni, and then maybe I can get to heaven. You know, if there's some redeeming, the redemption quality you can gain from the storytelling, that's also beautiful music. Mozart, beautiful music. But there's also a piece like Stravinsky's Rite of Spring. I mean, it's very distant, but it's still a wonderful piece of music, and you need to take into consideration, is there any beautiful message to take from that? It's an observation, maybe, of somebody's commentary on human nature, or either things someone recommend, whatever, okay. So you decide for yourself about that. Then, that's what I wanted to say. Then, the last point that I need to communicate that's so part of my mission in life is that we're all called. Every single person who's a Christian is called to be a missionary of beauty. That's why beautiful music is worth learning about and teaching people about and sharing with others. Because we have a duty to be evangelists. And we can be an evangelist through being a missionary of beauty. So just to talk about
Something that's referred to as the way of beauty is the term via pulchritudinis. And this is a pathway of seeking and growing a deeper relationship with Christ, educating our youth in beauty as a family, combating the ugliness of the world, and providing our youth with tools to combat evil, emotional distress, and existential emptiness. This is just rampant in our world right now on social media, on the internet, in different communities that are toxic, you know. These qualities are present, so how do we combat them? And some place to start might be with beauty. So beauty has the power of attraction and is paramount to evangelization. Beauty in our liturgy, especially the liturgy. Beauty in prayer and beauty in music. You probably heard the quote before by Dostoevsky from one of his books. It says, beauty will save the world. I believe beauty will save the world. And Pope Paul VI said in his message to artists in 1965, this world in which we live needs beauty in order not to sink into despair. It is beauty like truth which brings joy to the heart of man and is that precious fruit which resists the wear and tear of time, which unites generations and makes them share things in admiration. So you wonder why box music stands the test of time? It's because it's truly beautiful. If it wasn't beautiful, it wouldn't stand the test of time. Participating and observing beauty brings fulfillment, joy, and purpose to our hearts. Another little quote by the St. Pope John Paul II in his letter to artists in 1999, in his section under The Beauty That Saves, he says, may the beauty which you pass on to generations still to come be such that it will stir them to wonder. This is one of the most important points. Faced with the sacredness of life and of the human person and before the marvels of the universe, wonder is the only appropriate attitude. Beauty is a key to the mystery and a call to transcendence. It is an invitation to savor life and to dream of the future. That is why the beauty of created things can never fully satisfy. It stirs the hidden nostalgia for God, which a lover of beauty like St. Augustine could express in incomparable terms. Late have I loved you, beauty so old and so new. Late have I loved you. So we have a responsibility in this postmodern world to regain our connection to the transcendent and to create beauty in spite of the fallen world. We need to seek and display elements and the glimmers of God through the swamp of evil in the world. So after all of these ideas that I've put forth to you might be going on, how the heck do I, where do we start? What the heck do I do? Where do I go for the information about this? So I just put together some resources you'll see on the handouts. You can always email me after, ask for more resources, say what composer should I be listening to, should I be checking out. I could always give you a giant list of composers you can start looking at, including the ones from tonight. You can look up more music by the composers, except Milton Babbitt. So just to run through these resources really quick, we have the Catholic Institute of Sacred Music.org. I just found this resource recently, actually. It's a resource headed by Dr. Jennifer Donaldson, who used to teach at St. Joseph Seminary Yonkers. Now she's in California somewhere teaching at another seminary. She's a wonderful musician and has put together a lot of resources for sacred music. Where do you go to start listening to good sacred music? Look at these links and explore that. She also has classes you can take in sacred music, how to read, chant, things like that, right? And the second link is also her website, and I was going to put some of those resources here, and then I realized she had all of them on her list, so why not just share her one link? It leads you to like 20 other links. Okay, then a couple of podcasts that I really like that have good information about beautiful music and good things about liturgy and our Catholic life and culture are Square Notes, also Born of Wonder. It's done by a friend of a friend of mine, and everything on this podcast is things that this wonderful homeschool Catholic mom who loves and appreciates beauty and wonder talks about literature, music, art, anything that brings wonder. A few really good ones on there about music. Check it out. And then we have a couple of apps, such as the Hollow app. It's a Catholic prayer meditation app. They should really sponsor me because I promote this app all the time. But alas, this is not a paid sponsorship, but I highly recommend the app. It has a bunch of beautiful chants on there. It has polyphony. They have Lenten music. I was just looking more into it today. I was like, there's more here than I even thought. So if you want to play something in the car with your kids in the car, just pop on the app and click some of that sacred music. It's great.
And then also, as actually my friend Keith mentioned before, WQXR is the classical radio station that you can actually get an app on your phone for to play beautiful classical music anytime. And and the last thing is that I highly recommend joining a parish community choir, or maybe if you play a vocational instrument, join a community orchestra. This is a way to be in community with others, to create beautiful music, and to perform beautiful music, to share with others. This is something that's brought a lot of joy to my own life, and I love sharing with other people, so I really want to share that kind of idea. And we're private music lessons taught by a classically trained instructor. There are a lot of music teachers out there. Not everybody knows about the most beautiful music. Seek out somebody who's classically trained. Okay, and then just a final thing. In seeking to separate sound from objectively beautiful music, we are engaging in soul shaping. The philosopher Roger Scruton said, "It came as a surprise so that so dry a question as what is sound should lead at last to a philosophy of modern music, of modern culture. Had I thought more about the Pythagorean cosmology and the true meaning of harmonia, I should perhaps have known beforehand that the ordering of sound as music is an ordering of the soul." Thank you so much for coming today. Thank you to Father Savolka and Father Collier for inviting me to be here today.
We have some time for questions, yeah. Do you want to, maybe we use this mic for the questions and you can use that?
I think this is so loud. Oops, okay. A little bit weird.
Is that good?
I think it's okay. Can you hear me? Okay, great. I'll just talk. The quality's a little strange. Okay.
So this way, everyone will be able to hear the questions.
Yes, good idea.
Okay. Questions?
Somebody asked.
Beautiful presentation.
Oh.
I get that every day.
Oh.
I like myself. All right, this is from a truck driver's perspective, because all I listened to for about 30 years was. What do you think is our first instrument as people?
What do you think I'm going to say?
I'm kidding.
The first instrument, the instrument that you're born with, is your human voice. It's your God-given gift, and I'm a music teacher, I can tell you, absolutely anybody can sing. And if somebody wants to try to prove me wrong, take lessons with me. I'll give you a free lesson. The first lesson is free. And I'll show you that it's all about, so if anybody thinks that they're tone deaf or that they can't sing, it's all about how you're training your ear to listen to the music and how do you reflect that and how you feel it in your voice. Because if you can speak, you can sing. Basically, singing is amplified or more emotionally charged speech. So if I'm singing opera, I'm actually first I'm speaking the text, then I'm going to sing it. There has to be a reason to sing the text. So especially sacred music, if you're singing hymns in church, think about those words and pray with the hymns, because that is the best way to sing the hymns in church. If you think you're tone deaf, sing it out louder in church, because the angels hear it in tune in heaven.
I'm kind of alternating sides here, so. Okay.
I didn't have a question so much as a comment. You were talking about how beauty should speak the truth. And I find that a lot of present composers, like not classical composers, but like somebody like Taylor Swift or whoever, will say that a lot of their songs come out of their actual experiences or the things that they're going through now in life.
Mm-hmm.
And when they speak that truth, it gets a lot of reaction from the audience, and the record does very well.
Yes, okay, so, oh wait, so what is the question? Just a comment or a response? Okay, so yeah, I want to respond to that actually. That's There's so much in that I can respond to. So just one little idea maybe I'll put in a box, not go deep into it, is that a lot of contemporary artists and the general culture right now says, oh, I have to have an opportunity to speak my truth. What the heck? Like, truth is objective, right? So we have to observe any contemporary artist and look at the lyrics and say, is this actually true? Is this something that comes from God? Is this somebody's skewed perspective of reality? Okay, if we answer, no, this is pretty fair, this is true, then sometimes a way to even find some solace, you can relate to somebody else's suffering. Just like we relate to Christ's suffering, and we can, when he falls with the cross, okay, if I fell with a sin that I'm struggling with, that's relating to somebody's suffering. So even if a contemporary song has something a little bit messed up in it, we have to just evaluate with our conscience, with our informed conscience, are these lyrics something that is exuding evil, or is it exuding truth? And okay, maybe I can relate to this and find some solace in it. So, yeah. So that's what I was going to respond to. That was a great comment. Oh, yes.
Not a question, but looking for advice, especially for the youth. And how they can, you know, it would be for them to be easier to, you gave some of that right now, just something you mentioned something, but an advice for them, or how they can open, you know, their hearts, their ears towards the right music, which is very difficult right now,
yes.
And even for parents to transfer faith.
Yes, that is something I think about all the time, and I'm not yet a parent myself, but I have a lot of young students, and I am involved in communities with a lot of young children, and I think it really starts, the first thing primarily is from the home. So even if kids are going to school, they're not homeschooled, if they're out in the world, when they're with you at home for the short time you're able to have them, play some Gregorian chant in the background, or just play some beautiful music that you know of. Play some Vivaldi, play something in the house while dinner's going on, maybe softly, so that you can start introducing these sounds that they're not used to hearing, and maybe it'll send them a message like, oh wow, this is really peaceful. Maybe you'll be less likely to have an argument at the dinner table. I don't know, try it out, you know? So, and even exorcist priests have said if you play Gregorian chant, the Latin is very powerful on the Lord's side. So if you play Latin Gregorian chant in the background of your home, if there's some evil in the home, that can start influencing it in a good way. So I would say start playing some music in your home or in the car, when you're in the car, and then have a conversation with your kid about it. Say, hey, what do you think of this? Or, you know, it's actually very funny. I was thinking about social media and a way, any light that can be gotten from it, anything positive, and there is a little bit of positivity. You can, I forget the name of the account, but there are a couple of accounts of teenagers dancing to Vivaldi music, like dancing in like a hip-hop dance movements, and it's so fun to watch. They're just bopping along, and they're dancing to some classical music, so it's actually getting kids turned on to some of the beauty of this older music as well. So there is some of that stuff out there on the internet. It's hard to find, and there's more evil than good, I think, on the internet for kids, but start with it in your home, see how the kids react to it, say, oh, I'm going to show you this other piece. I think that is the place to start. There's so much more that can be said there, but because music education isn't always going to be the same in every school, et cetera, et cetera. But hopefully that's some place you can start off. Take some of these composers in the handout and just look up their music on YouTube and then see how the kids react to it. Be like, hey, this is kind of a cool beat, and like bop along to it.
So I thought it was very interesting that you mentioned that the vocal cords are basically instruments, because a couple weeks ago in my Wisdom and Literature course, we were looking at the Genesis chapter 2, when Adam, you know, basically sings out, you know, bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. And scripture scholars are in debate whether that's an actual composed text of like song or not. But nonetheless, we were discussing how there's something about music, something about man, I should say, that is predisposed to wanting to lose himself in music, and music like transcends him to the divine, as you hit on. And so, the question we never really like answered, so if you have any comments about, is like, okay, we experience this music, it's some of the pieces that you played tonight, the different responses we have, but I guess maybe more metaphysical, like contemplation, like what the music itself, like why is it that we lose ourselves in music? Why is it that it has some sort of like grasp on our soul and that we can actually lose ourselves in it? You know, any comments on that would be great.
Yes. Oh my gosh. I mean, that's actually the question I started with when I tried to start planning this talk, and I was like, how do I even begin to start answering this question? So I think, so there's certain music, like I was saying before, that evokes a very similar emotional response from multiple people. It might be something causing anxiety or causing joy or something like that, but the qualities, and it's hard to say that that's really not subjective. If it's a piece of beautiful music, it's going to evoke a similar feeling. So I think that I think the first time, well, you said that Adam sang out, right? Okay, so there's also, I think one of the other first times somebody sings out is in the book of Genesis. It's somewhere else. It may be, after the parting of the Red Sea, I think the Israelites sing out. That might be the other first place that people talk about people sing out in praise to God. So it was evoked after a feeling that these people were in captivity for so long. They were with the chains, you know, and then they were set free. Whoa, this is an experience that the first notation in the Bible is for joy. So, okay, this is one of the fundamental places when somebody reacted to a feeling with song. So there's a lot of purpose for music even found within different Bible passages and different instruments that are used, plucked lyres in the Psalms, David playing in the harp and singing to God, praise to God. So that's why a lot of these primary purposes and functions of music come from glory and praise to God, something that should lift our eyes to the Lord. And because God is something that's also transcendental, like the beautiful music experience is also transcendental, you can't put a finger on why does this music make me cry? You know, I'm sure everybody can think of the first time, hopefully you can think of the first time that music, a piece of music, touched you unexpectedly. You might go to a concert saying, oh, I'm going to hear some really beautiful music tonight. I know what they're playing, their repertoire. But you might have been surprised that, oh my gosh, this piece of music really touched me and I wasn't expecting that. Why does that happen? It pulls on your heartstrings. Like, oh, Father Savolka sent the quote from Pope Benedict XVI saying this cantata by Bach very unexpectedly pulled at his heartstrings and touched him. Why does that happen? So it's these qualities of the music that give us an escape from the weakness in the fallen world. And if music has that quality, it's very worth getting lost in it and lifting your eyes to God. So I don't know if I really answered the question. It's kind of hard to answer. But is that something else to think about?
Yeah. I just
want
to hear some comments.
Cool.
Yeah.
Christa, I wonder if you could comment on the difference between music that moves us into that transcendent realm, moves us to the divine. It may touch our emotions, and music that would be more characterized by sentimentality or emotionalism.
Like the purpose of it is the emotional response instead of the content of it?
Right,
okay. That is an interesting distinction to make. So I guess what I was exploring with researching this topic is that if music's sole purpose is the emotional response or something other than these other qualities of the integrity, clarity, and transcendence, then if something is just to try to evoke anger or sadness or something, it's not truly beautiful music. But it can be useful for our emotions to equate, we can relate to those songs, even like the contemporary songs I was talking about, that pop music that's easily forgettable. But the pop music that's easily forgettable, that may just be for the purpose of evoking emotion, isn't going to stand the test of time. So that was one of the points I was going to make, that if it's just to evoke emotion, then It's not gonna last for the next 100 years. It might be forgotten about next year, you know, or in the next couple of years. That's kind of the difference, I think.
Hi, Christa.
Hi, Kelly.
I just wanted to comment because before you were talking about like children and classical music, you know, I'm an artist, and in our studio one day we had a bunch of kids, and they were like really rowdy. They were running around like crazy people. And you know, especially when you're drawing, it requires concentration, and sometimes children just, they react. And so instead of yelling at them, we decided to put classical music on. And within a few minutes, those kids were focused, and they were drawing and painting and doing what they were told to do. And really, it was just tremendous power in classical music that we experienced. So then we just started doing it every week. Classical music on. So there's that power, that beauty that children react to.
Yes. Oh, okay. That is so beautiful. And something that I'll maybe return a comment with is that some quality about children that I think we lose as adults is something that they react, especially young children, very viscerally and immediately to emotional responses. They don't think about how someone's going to perceive it, and they just react and they do it, right? And so, and I think sometimes as adults, we lose that sense of childlike wonderment. I think that's maybe a quality of children that we should try to keep in our spirits, is that if we had the wonderment like children have, maybe we would be more open to opening our hearts and letting in the peace that you can receive from a work of music. So if you're not totally open to it, I mean, even a beautiful piece of music may not affect you very much, but for a child listening to classical music, they're just more open, you know what I'm saying? So I think that's a very interesting quality about children to try to keep as adults.
I love your talk, I really, really love it. I have a question. I was writing a lot of stuff that you said. I'm an artist, and I'm trying to also bring beauty in my art. And I was writing, but you finished first. You said something like, the last thing that you said, the order of the music triggers the order of the soul, or you said that we can...
The last quote that
yes,
I
said. Yes, the last one he said.
Okay, so this is from the philosopher Roger Scruton, and he said, "It came as a surprise that so dry a question as what is a sound should lead at last to a philosophy of modern culture." So it has to do with modern culture, the question. Had I thought more about Pythagorean cosmology and the true meaning of harmonia, I should have perhaps known that the ordering of a sound as music is an ordering of the soul. So the ordering of these sounds even come from our voice, or sounds in nature, or like a sound like this. The ordering of a sound is the ordering of your soul.
Thank you.
No problem.
More of a comment. Coming from a science background and teaching children, I thought it was interesting regarding what I think you said Kelly said about children. An interesting famous experiment that kids do for science fairs are with plants, and they take whatever three plants and expose that plant to classical music for, you know, a week or whatever. And in another room, they have another three plants, and they expose those three plants to like Neri, Black Sabbath, hard rock, whatever, Beatles, music. And they have proven, the children have proven at various science fairs that the plants that were exposed to the Neri, you know, evil hard rock music were not thriving and almost dead. And the plants that were exposed to the classical music were thriving. Mm. And the plants also, they are controlled. The plants were had the same amount of light and water, et cetera, that you would give a plant. So I always found that very interesting. And
yes.
And we should all try that.
Right. Yeah, I want to try that now. That's awesome. Wow, yeah, one thing of God's creation, even though it's not sentient, it doesn't have free will like we do, but God's creation in a plant can definitely react the same way as God's creation in us, our souls can react to. That's awesome. Thanks for that comment. That's so cool.
Hi, Kelly. Just piggybacking on what the lady said about plants. I'm a plant lover, and I do the music and stuff also in my home. And she's right what she said, the music, the classical music, and the soft tone music that we play, the plants really do thrive.
Wow.
So that is, I can say, actually, it's true. It works.
That's awesome. Thanks for sharing that. I'm going to try it.
Hi. One thing that we have forgotten over the years, I remember many years ago, the very old cartoons that were silent, many of the sound was classical music set to the cartoons.
Yes.
You don't see that anymore.
Yes, actually, it's very rare to see something like that, but there, around Halloween time, a couple of my colleagues who play the organ, actually, did these magnificent concerts where there would be a black and white film playing, and they would do an organ improvisation to the entire black and white film. It's the coolest thing ever. So once in a while, so seek out things like that that are really cool. Also, something that that reminded me of was, I think maybe kids from my generation will know that a lot of their first exposure to classical music was Looney Tunes. How all the heads are shaking, right? Because like, you picture Bugs Bunny with his hands on Elmer Fudd's head, right? So the classical music was really made an impact on us kids from that generation. So it's really interesting to note that. So cool.
Commercials too.
Yeah. Yes, exactly. Right, because people might think, oh, kids today, they don't like the old classic stuff, they don't like the chant, they don't like this. If you show kids this stuff, they eat it up like a sponge. I started doing chant with my children's choir at church. They love it. They love it more than the English stuff. I'm like, whoa, you guys are so cool. The kids, just they're attracted to beauty. They have their guard let down to be closed off about things, and they're attracted to beauty in this classical music. So that's so cool. I'm just so fascinated by children. They're so cool.
I don't need the microphone. Did everyone enjoy your Von Bingham rendition? Okay. Is there any chance that we could get an encore?
Oh my God! I don't know.
Encore! Encore!
Really?
Thank you.
So maybe the last question is, if we want to hear you perform, or how do we find out where to hear you perform?
Thanks so much for asking. These days, I'm doing this doctorate at Manhattan School of Music. I have a couple of recitals left for the degree, so a couple more will be performed on the Upper West Side at Manhattan School of Music. The next recital will be a chamber recital of music by Vivaldi, actually, also Handel. Also Hildegard von Bingen, I have a few chants of hers on there, and Mozart, and one other, I forget. That's going to be May 13th. I have a few other things, but I just asked where you could see. So I should really be better about updating my website and sending out newsletters and things like that. So the best way is to follow me on social media, because that's something that I do, you know, shortly before I give some people some notice when a performance is coming up. So the social media, I should have put it on the handout, whoops. But my Facebook is my name, Christa Dalmazio. You can friend me in there if you like. Maybe send me a message saying, hey, I saw your talk, I'm not just a random person. So I'll accept your request. And then on Instagram, it's Christa Dalmazio and _ musicista in Italian is the word for musician in Italian. So if you want me to write that down for you, just come up afterwards, I can write it down for you. And then my next step is to be better about the website, but just follow my social media and you can see what's coming up for me.
Great, thanks.
Thank you so much, thank you.
Don't leave yet. There are refreshments in the back. If you'd like to stick around and enjoy some time together more informally. And make sure to come back and join us again next Wednesday, when our speaker next week will be Zeke Phelan, who is an architect Father Peter and I have known for a long time. And he's about to become more famous, I think, because he's designed what will become the first dedicated permanent perpetual adoration chapel in Manhattan. Come back to hear Zeke next week, and have a good evening, get home safe, and God bless you all. Thanks for being with us tonight.
Thank you.